Christ is risen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Before we continue into the Kyrie today, I'd like to take a moment to do a short children's sermon. If there are any children here today that would like to come forward.
That's Jesus' peace flowing out of the stuff. It just keeps flowing, just like water does. So when we sing the hymn of praise at this moment, what I'd like to do is tell people around, we can sprinkle everything. Just a little bit. So if you have glasses, you may want to show those. It's body glasses. Just be full. All right. Let's continue.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, the strength of those who believe and the hope of those who doubt, may we who have not seen have faith in you and receive the fullness of Christ's blessing, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Thank you.
Confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, "He was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Judeans, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails in my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
If you'd like to join me in grabbing a hymnal for just a moment and turning to song number 386, I'll invite you to maybe just follow along, or if you're even feeling up to it, maybe sing along with me. "Oh sons and daughters, let us sing." Oh sons and daughters, even that title kind of connects us right back to our baptismal connections, our baptismal identity as children of God. This hymn is a nice one to share this day, because it kind of recaps the Easter story for everybody and then goes on to share a synopsis of the Thomas story as well. O sons and daughters, let us sing with heavenly hosts to Christ our King. Today the grave has lost its sting. Alleluia. That Easter morn at break of day, the faithful woman went their way to seek the tomb where Jesus lay. Alleluia. An angel clad in white they see, who sits and speaks unto the three. Your Lord will go to Galilee. Alleluia. Your Lord will go to Galilee, and he will meet you there. This is the gospel that we heard just last week on Easter Sunday. But this promise of the empty tomb is, it's more than just a promise. It also contains an expectation, a mission, if you will. And that mission that is fundamental to this promise is that those whom the Lord will meet must go forth. To meet the Lord, we must go out. They cannot hunker down. They cannot remain sheltered up. They cannot remove themselves from the roadways, from the intersections of God's world. Yes, the people who received the good promise of Easter are being sent out to Galilee, out to Samaria, to Syria, to Lebanon, to Corinth, to Rome, to all the world. They're being sent out. In fact, this is what the word apostle means. Someone who goes out. Someone who goes forth with a message. But here we are today, and the witness that John is bringing to us is the disciples, well, they weren't going out. They weren't going to Galilee. They weren't going through Samaria. They weren't going anywhere. They were staying put. They were staying behind locked doors. In a way, John's testimony became true not only of those very first disciples in those days following Christ's resurrection, but also, in a way, for the church itself. Since that very first Easter day when the angel announced, "He is going before you," a chronic temptation for Christ's church has been to, well, not go, to stay behind closed doors, to stay safely within the world of the private and the personal. Because behind a closed door, the dilemmas of spiritual, family, and personal concerns, well, they can be handled safely, quietly, carefully, and securely. Behind a closed door, the message of the gospel can be received and embraced without risking embarrassment or exposure or the betrayal of others. Beyond those doors, though, on the other side, are the risky public and social worlds that can occupy our lives. Beyond that closed door are the economic, political, and civic realities that occupy most of our waking hours. Beyond that door, the gospel's promise. Well, on days it can be scarcely acknowledged, dimly glimpsed, and very often considered quite out of place. Beyond that door can be a world that threatens us with betrayal and death, with failure, embarrassment, and yes, with doubt and fear. That night the apostles met in fear. Among them came their master dear, and said, "My peace be with you here. Alleluia." When Thomas first the tidings heard that they had seen the risen Lord, he doubted the disciples' word. Alleluia. He doubted the disciples' word. Alleluia. It sounds kind of ridiculous, doesn't it? It's not really the kind of statement that should be followed by an alleluia. Alleluia is supposed to follow something a lot more positive, right? Something like, Christ is risen.
Alleluia.
Yeah, you got it. Praise the Lord.
Alleluia.
Peace be with you.
Alleluia.
Alleluia. He doubted the disciples' word? Doesn't feel right, does it? Doesn't feel right. Thomas's doubt, we call it, but it wasn't really Thomas's alone. It was the same doubt that had kept all the other disciples behind closed doors in the first place. At least Thomas had the courage to be out somewhere on that first day. No, Thomas is not alone in his doubt. All of them had doubt and fear. The doubt of accusations that might be coming their way, the doubt of persecution. The doubt and the fear that they might be next on the cross. And all of these doubts keep them locked up behind closed doors. But those doors and those locks, they do not keep out the risen Jesus. Suddenly, Jesus stands there among them with a proclamation that the peace that he promised for them in his ministry has now been achieved in his resurrection, in his ascension, and glorification. Peace be with you, Jesus proclaims. Peace be with you. But it is an unexpected peace, a peace not given according to the expectations of our world. The peace Jesus gives is not a peace of retirement. It's not the peace that comes through government law or a strong military. It's not the peace of a relaxing day at the lake. And it's not the peace of a night of restful sleep. Rather, the peace that Jesus brings is a peace that comes with a new status and a new role. The ones who receive Jesus' peace are no longer merely disciples. When they receive Jesus' peace, they become apostles. They are ones who are sent out into the world. Just as God sends Jesus himself. Peace be with you. As my Father has sent me, so I send you. So I send you. Jesus' peace is a peace that pushes the Christian community, both then and now. It's a peace that sends us outward from the rooms and the spaces in which we want to find safety. It's a peace that pushes us to undo the locks, to open the doors, and go forth into a world where good and evil can be wrestling. To go out into a world that is threatened by destruction, and yet at the same time, a world that lives in hope of the fulfillment of God's promises. This is the peace that Jesus brings among us. A peace that sends us out. Peace that sends us out to be apostles in this world today. Not apostles because we know all things or because we can answer all the questions and all the doubts of faith, but apostles because that is who God makes us to be. In sending the Holy Spirit, God's own creative breath, into our hearts, into our lungs, and into our very being. This is who God makes us to be. In our baptism, it's the peace and the water and the Spirit that can't be stopped by any locked door. This is the peace of a new commission, a charge to carry the same holy breath, the same holy water, the same holy peace to others, and to exercise a sanctifying influence in the midst of the struggles of this world. This is the peace that makes each and every one of you an apostle. Now, I can see it a little bit in the body language out there of some of you. You're wondering about this. There's a little bit of doubt, maybe. Doubt that you are being sent in this way. Doubt that you might be called and sent out into a public situation and into a vulnerable position, into an uncertain struggle. Doubt that the word apostle might apply to any, to all of us. But in the midst of such doubt, there is also the hope of faith and emergence. Because rooted in doubt is also the kernel, the seed of what might be. Because in the very act of doubting, in the very act of doubting that we are apostles, we also must entertain the possibility that we are. In doubting that we are sent, we also face the potential belief that maybe we actually are sent. Alleluia. And so as you begin to see here It's not doubt, not Thomas's, not the disciples, and not ours, that keeps us from the action of peace to which God calls us. It's simply a little bit of fear. It's simply fear that keeps us behind closed doors, that keeps us from being the apostles that Jesus calls us to be at all times. Simply fear. Alleluia. I say alleluia because it is precisely this sometimes separating fear which Jesus conquers. Which Jesus conquers when he gives us his peace. The fear, maybe, that we are alone. Gone. Peace be with you. The fear that we are forgotten. It's gone. With peace be with you. The fear that we may not be loved. The fear that we may be unworthy. The fear that we may die. Gone, gone, gone. Peace be with you. This is the ultimate life-giving power of Christ's peace. A peace that cannot be contained by any lock, by any door, by any wall, by any cup or glass. A peace that is not obstructed by any of our fears. And for that peace, we can indeed say, Alleluia!
Alleluia!
For Thomas's doubt, we can say, Alleluia! For our doubt, we can say, Alleluia! For all the doubt which creates a space for Jesus to come and see and say to each and every one of us, peace be with you. My peace is with you. My pierced side, O Thomas, see, and look upon my hands, my feet, not faithless, but believing be. Alleluia. No longer Thomas then denied. He saw the feet, the hands, the side. You are my Lord and God, he cried. Alleluia. How blessed are they who have not seen, and yet whose faith has constant been, for they eternal life shall win. Alleluia. On this most holy day of days, be laud and jubilee and praise. To God your hearts and voices raise. Alleluia. 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 Alleluia.
Thank you. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. We believe that God creates all things. We believe Earth is a sanctuary, a sacred planet filled with God's presence, a home for us to share with all humanity. We believe that the risen Jesus is the Christ at the core of creation, reconciling all things to God, renewing all creation, and filling the universe.
We believe the Spirit renews life in creation, groans in
Rejoicing in the risen life of Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. We pray for the church. Breathe your Spirit into us. Renew us with your power. Unite us in mission and send us into the world with your love. Lord, in your mercy. For the earth, for fields and forests, gardens and vineyards, and all newly planted crops, sustain our world with clean water and favorable weather. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the nations, empower leaders to work for the well-being of all. Send peace into every place where people live in the shadow of violence and displacement. Free all who are isolated behind walls of fear. Lord, in your mercy. For those in need, look with compassion toward those who bear hidden wounds. Draw near to those who seek you. Comfort the dying, console the grieving, and heal the sick. Especially Carol Bickle, Henry Bremenkamp, Jeannie Burnell Graves, Ron Callen, the Cass family, Cliff Dykeman, Jeff Dykeman, Claudia Farrell, Lisa Grady, Ed Heinz, Mark Henson, Haley Hubbard, Debbie Huff, Ivy Ruth Johnson, Vera Kimsey, Shirley Masters, the Amaretta McGee family, Audrey Pierce, John Fursich, Pat Roper, Nellie Seward, Janet Smith, Chris Snyder, Pat Sfigera, Steve Swaim, Jennifer Umland, Kim Wohl, Marietta Young, and Margaret Biggs. Are there others? Lord, in your mercy, for this assembly, give us courage to welcome newcomers graciously. Walk with those who are inquiring, those who harbor doubts and questions, and those who are absent from us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For Nolan Charles Roark Davis at his baptism today, together with all the newly baptized, raise him up with your Spirit. Feed him with your word and empower him to be your hands in a broken world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We offer prayers of thanksgiving for the family and friends of Spencer Elaham, the healthy grandson of Lisa and Carl Westland. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We offer prayers for the safety and travel and for their training as Jean Barty and Vicki Donnell attend the Stephen Ministry Leaders Training Course in St. Louis, Missouri this week. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With thanksgiving, we remember those who have died in faith, especially Keith Hunt. Inspire us by their witness. Bring us with them to the heavenly feast. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Joining our voices with your faithful ones in every time and every place, we offer our prayers in the name of the risen one, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Merciful God, be known to
us, Lord, bread of the bread, as you were made known to the disciples. Receive these gifts and offering of our lives, that we may be your risen body in the world. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens of the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth and the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith, saying, "Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again." O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence as we cry out, "Come, Holy Spirit."
Come, Holy Spirit.
Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love, as we call out, "Come, Holy Spirit."
Come, Holy Spirit.
With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father,
in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen. Now let us feast this Easter day on Christ, the bread of heaven. Alleluia. Christ given for you. Jesus, bless this your child. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed 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 for you. the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Thanks be to you forever. And justice you taught us, thanks be to you forever. Strong is your faithfulness, strong is your love. Remembering your covenant of life with us. Praise to you, O God of mercy, thanks be to you forever. Praising I the meek and lowly, thanks be to you forever. Thanks be to you forever.
Life-giving God, in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection, you send light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of heaven to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to Jesus' resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world. Through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen. Are there announcements to share today from the congregation?
Just like to say that the congregation here can use a little help this week. As you can see, I think we have about 18 lilies, 10 have left, 10 of them which still look really good. We need to get them to our homebound. I would just encourage any of you who know someone, take it. Otherwise, we'll put the list in the office, and Tracy will have that list. You can go there and see one of our members that might appreciate one of the lilies. We appreciate your help. Thank you.
Hi. So in January, we have all of the seniors have the men singing for the month of January. We are going to do the same thing with the women for May. So we invite any of you who might have the urge to sing with us to come and join us in May. The first practice date is wrong because the Lenten is actually May 3rd, May 7th. This is Sunday. So if you'd like to join us for that, we would love to have you.
I just want to tell you about the Springfield Mid-America Singers. We will be beginning our 50th anniversary in this fall. However, next Sunday, there is a performance at 3 p.m. It's a free performance at Redeemer Lutheran Church. Please come. It's a requiem for the living, if you can believe that. Okay, please come. I'll say again next Sunday, too.
Next Sunday is the fifth Sunday of the month, and so we have the fifth Sunday potluck after the 11 o'clock service. There is a sign-up sheet back there. How many people you're bringing, entree, salad, or dessert. Thank you.
Are there any other announcements to share? Today is my last Sunday scheduled with you at this time, and I just want to thank each and every one of you for the time that I've been able to be with you through the few weeks in Lent and the big opening of this Easter season. It's been both a blessing to me and a gift to me to be among such wonderful people. And I wish you the best, and may God continue to be with you as you move through your time of transition and as you move to welcoming your interim pastor. May God be with you. Thank you so much. As we share the blessing, I'm going to add just a little bit to that today. I want to add just a little bit. I've borrowing something that was written for the soup ministries, the soup missions in Oslo, Norway, part of their dismissal for a worship service. And so I'm going to share just an adjusted form for that with you in a moment. But let us now share the benediction and then that dismissal. God has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and raise you to life both now and forever. Amen. And now as we share in this dismissal today, I invite you to go. To go and be disciples. To go and never stop going out from church, out from peace and stillness, out into noise and discomfort, out to tears and laughter. Carry with you the peace that you were given here as a treasure between your hands and in your heart, and share it again and again and again. It will suffice forever. And also come. Come. Never stop coming back to this place. Never come with empty hands. Bring with you the doubts and the fears that may lock you in. Let them sound here. Bring with you the hunger that is never stilled, the emptiness that seeks, the fight that is not yet won. Bring with you one who has always been at your side without you knowing it. Here is the meeting place in the light of Christ. Peace be with you. Alleluia.
Guided by the gospel, we welcome all. Go in peace, share the good news. Alleluia.
Thank you. Amen.